بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله على إحسانه والشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له تعظيما لشأنه، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله الداعي إلى رضوانه، صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وإخوانه ومن سار على نهجه واكتفى أثره واستنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، respected brothers, distinguished sisters in Islam, we begin off by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, as all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the glorified, the magnificent, the most exalted. And we equally send salutations and his blessings upon the paragon of his creation, none other than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we begin off by conveying upon ourselves the greetings of peace, the greetings of the people of Jannah, yawma yalqawnahu salama. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Respected brothers and sisters, I really didn't want to use the podium because I am a very informal form of a speaker. Specifically when I'm interacting with the youth who I find they relate to me the most, I love to make my sessions very interactive. And as it is, I'm not a speaker, I'm actually a teacher. A speaker is one person, you know, when he starts speaking and he introduces his topic to the others and the audience start falling asleep. A teacher is one who makes his students interactive and he expects them to be very responsive. And this is what I actually wanted to do, but because we have the media mics at place too, there's no two ways I could go about it. But nonetheless, inshallah. Now, this was a very sudden visit for me. I was not supposed to be here today, but my senior, Sheikh Abdul Razak, met me yesterday, and he persisted and persisted and persisted for me to please attend. So in respect to him and the brother and the fellow brothers, inshallah, I will try and share something very beautiful with you. Respected brothers, look, we are all youth, is it? Anyone who is below the age of 40 to raise your hands. Anyone below the age of 40? Below the age of 40, fine. MashaAllah, that's everyone. Now tell me on the other side, everyone above the age of 40? Above the age of 40? One. Above the age of 40? Why do people... I never knew that women love to make themselves old. SubhanAllah. Above the age of 40, anyone? Only one hand I can see, and another hand from the brother, MashaAllah. That's why I'm saying this is a session for the youth. We need to understand one thing. In Islam, over the decades, over the generations that have passed, Islam has ever found its strength through the blood of the youth. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he got at the pedestal of caliphate, he was a young, energetic, robust sahaba. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he accompanied the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he embraced Islam and he brought his financial strength and he consolidated the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was in the prime of his youth. Uthman bin Affan radiallahu ta'ala anhu, radiya anhu al-Rahman, was in the prime of his youth. Ali bin Abi Talib, we all know by studying the seerah, the very first youth, young person who embraced Islam was Ali bin Abi Talib, a cousin to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a toddler who grew on the blessed laps of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Islam has ever nourished, always nourished through the blood of the youth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in numerous verses, he calls upon us. He invokes us. He evokes that feeling within us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Ahzab, he says, Min al-mu'minina rijal. Amidst the believers, a man. Now, rijal, by saying man, it doesn't necessarily mean only men. Biologically, men. No. Even women are inclusive. Rijal is just a term. In Arabic, Imam al-Awza'i rahimahullah ta'ala says, كل رجل الذي يترجل. رجل is derived from Ra, Jim, Lam. Ram, Jim, Lam is the very root word of the feet. What is the feet? Call it in Arabic, Rijl. Everyone who walks on his two feet is a Rajul, in that sense. Even women are inclusive in this ayah. من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه ومنهم من ينتظر. A reference to ourselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says beautifully, من المؤمنين رجال. From the believers, amidst the believers, were people of substance, were people of essence. Ali bin Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he took the caliphate, he ascended the member of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the pulpit, and he said, نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ, because that was a time of difficulty. The Ummah was going through trials. Uthman bin Affan's blood was just shed. His martyrdom was just fresh in the minds of the believers. They wanted to avenge. And Ali bin Abi Talib is taking over a bickering Ummah, a bickering nation. And he was articulate and he was baligh, profound in his statements. He ascended the minbar and he said, نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ نَحْتَاجُ إِلَى رِجَالٍ فَعَلَّ قَوَّالٍ. We need men of action and substance, not men of mere statements. Just not people who talk. مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٍ صَدَقُوا مَا عَاهَدُ اللَّهَ عَلَيْهِ. They were truthful to their promise with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are truthful with their covenant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, amazing. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَهِ. Some of them have done their job and passed on. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the prophets before him, the sahabas, the khalifas, all of them, they did what they had to do, they passed on. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظِرُ. But know amidst you there are those who are yet alive and yet waiting to fulfill this covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tell me if this ayah is not a reference to us, me and you. Who? And I always keep on saying, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a youth, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spends the bulk of your youth, the brunt of your youth in his path. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam guaranteed, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks revelation. وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى مَا ظَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ وَمَا غَوَى وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. Whatever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam utters is not but revelation. I can doubt what I see, I can doubt what I hear. But the moment the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says something, I submit myself in totality. There's no room for doubt. That's the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam promised. He promised. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaking as a medium from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not break his promises. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam guaranteed those youth, الشاب الذي نشأ في عبادة الله, who grew up in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who grew up consolidating the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who grew up as du'at, callers out to this word, promulgators of Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guaranteed you that you will be under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. You will be under his shadow that he would have created for specifically those people who spent the brunt of their youth calling out to Islam. Those people who spent their youth in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a grand opportunity for me and you. Wallahi, it's a grand opportunity. You should be proud. And you should take pride in this. And you deserve to take pride in this. If you know that you are in your youth, you are a teenager, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed you in your worship, you should be thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at every instance, every second, every minute that passes by you. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many of our youth, and I keep on telling this to my respectful youth, and I keep on invoking them and appealing to them, how many people out there are not blessed with what you are not blessed with what you have been blessed with? It's a ni'mah, and it's something that necessitates the gratitude of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you are present today in a gathering for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكُمْ لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you are grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will increase you. Respected brothers, we need to understand the sensitivity of what is within our hands. We need to understand what we have been created for. As believers, as Muslims, we are men of direction. We are people of a direction. The Sahaba were a people of direction. The believers should be people of direction. If you really don't know what's the objective of your creation, why you were created, what's the purpose behind all this? Dr. Ali Muhammad Salah yesterday in our masjid, he gave us lecture, 1 hour plus, just with respect to who we are as Muslims and what's our objective and purpose in life. Very important to our youth. I mean, we end up reading the lives and biographies of what looks like a rosy picture, quote unquote, of celebrities who have no direction in life. The very same person who called himself, quote unquote, a celebrity, a music artist, an actor or actress, as famous as they are in their own lives, they are the worst and most evil people on the face of earth. The very same person, when he reaches the pinnacle of fame, if you look at his life with respect to his domestic life, his social life, they are the very same people who molest young children, who rape young women, and so on and so forth, and the list is ongoing. The person who was meant to be a source and medium of direction, and the people who are meant to be so, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum themselves, we don't bother reading their biographies. If these are the people who brought the Shahada, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, to us, these are the people we have to pay tribute to. These are the people whose biographies we are supposed to be reading. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's sad to stop a youth today and ask him about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, his Meccan period, what did he go through, the Medinan period, what did he go through, and the youth is just aghast, he knows nothing with regards to that. شهد الأنام بفضله حتى العدا والفضل ما شهد به الأعداء. The poet beautifully says, شهد الأنام بفضله, even the enemies, the entire universe, the entire globe, on a micro level, on a macro level, they bear testimony to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم's أخلاق, to his صدق, to his أمانة, حتى العدا, to the extent even his own enemies had to pay homage to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he's the most honest man on the face of earth. And the poet says, which is the culmination of the two couplets, wal fadlu ma shahidat bihi al a'da'u, real virtue is what your enemies pay tribute to, not your friend. If you want to know the substance of a man, the excellence of a man, ask his enemies with regards to him. I will draw you back today. Probably this is what we'll discuss about, and I will terminate my lecture with that. I only have 40 or 50 minutes on the clock. A beautiful incident, a beautiful hadith narrated by a beautiful Sahaba, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Prior to Islam, but after this incident, he embraced Islam and he became one of the most fervent followers of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is an incident in Sirah. We all know the hadith, but probably we don't know the context of the hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ya ayyuha an-nas, afshu as-salam wa at'imu at-ta'am wa silu al-arham wa sallu wan-nas niyam tadkhulu jannata rabbikum bi salam. Rawahu al-Imam al-Bukhari wa Muslim rahimahum Allah ta'ala. Authentic hadith. We all have listened, or in some at some point in our life read this hadith, haven't we? Have you heard this hadith? We have heard it. We really don't know its meaning and how profound the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is, and how much in need we as the youth are of this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even the context of this hadith matches our context, matches the context of our times, the problems of the youth, the responsibilities of the youth. What are we supposed to be doing? As I keep on saying, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, respected brothers and elders and sisters, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you an ambassador of this religion. Pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you an ambassador of this religion. And if not an ambassador, then pray dearly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to make you a hurdle, an obstacle in the path of His religion. If at least you can't be an ambassador, be a caller out to Islam through your actions, through your statements. People should draw close to Islam just by who we are, just by the identity we possess as Muslims. The bulk of the Sahaba accepted Islam on the hands of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not because of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's statements, but because of who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam carried himself, the akhlaq, the perfect akhlaq of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the infallible conduct of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his moral ethics and values is what drew people close to Islam. And this is why I need to mention the context of this hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we all know, migrated from Mecca to Medina. Upon the arrival of Medina, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam arrived in Medina, there was a Jewish rabbi amidst the Jews. This Jewish rabbi, and the Jews, for your information, for those who don't know, they were not residents and inhabitants of Medina initially. Ultimately, yes, initially, no. They were the residents of Egypt, as the Quran states, followers of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, towards the latter life of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, ordered them to travel to Sham. Ya qawmi dakhulu al-ard al-muqaddasata allati kataba Allahu lakum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Ma'idah, through Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, orders Banu Israel to migrate to the blessed lands, that's Sham. And that's not Sham, which is today translated as Syria, or the current country of Syria. Sham is a larger piece of land, which constitutes Palestine, Jerusalem, and all those areas now. Nonetheless, they migrated to Sham. But most of them were knowledgeable. They were well acquainted with their book, Torah. And amongst them were scholars, Jewish rabbis. They had read in the Torah that there will come a prophet towards the end of times, Ismuhu Ahmad, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah As-Saff. Hence they migrated, when the time came close, they migrated from Sham to Medina in anticipation of the newly sent prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Amidst them was this Jewish rabbi, well acquainted with Torah. He says, I was eagerly awaiting the advent of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the emergence of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the day came when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was to arrive in Medina. And I was amongst the earliest throngs, the earliest crowds of people who went to welcome the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Medina. And he says, I came out, and I was off the front of the people who were on the front line waiting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mounted on his camel, and Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, accompanying the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, approached Medina. And there was a thrill that trickled the hearts of people awaiting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is a Jewish rabbi. He gazed at the countenance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the blessed face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said a beautiful statement, and he is yet not a Muslim. He said, Wallahi fa'araftu anna wajhahu laysa biwajhi kadhib. He says, just as I had a glance at the face, the countenance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I automatically understood within myself that this blessed face is not the face of a liar. Can you imagine what the countenance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam possessed? Those spiritual nur that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had blessed the face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said these statements. This Jewish rabbi, prior to the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's a non-Muslim. He heard the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, memorized it, embraced it, spread it, and at the end of the hadith, he's a Muslim. This Jewish rabbi was none other than Abdullah bin Salam radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And by the way, for your information, this hadith has also been given a title by the muhaddithun, by the scholars of hadith. It's also known as the hadith of Salam. A hadith in the realm, in the sciences of hadith, if it is of great substance, great importance, it's given a title, like the hadith of Jibreel, when Jibreel descended in the form of a human and he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, asked him six fundamental questions of Islam, which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered. It's known as hadith of Jibreel according to the muhaddithun. The same thing here, it's known as hadith as-salam. Why? Because the narrator is Abdullah ibn Salam. The hadith starts with salam and it ends with salam. A great message to all of us. This is a religion of salam. What is salam? I will explain. As Muslims, we should be the torchbearers of Islam. Salam. And if people really don't learn what Islam is through you as Muslims, I mean, we have a huge voice out of the world there, which is raising, insulting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, insulting the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Who are they supposed to learn the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from, if not us? If they see within us not bearing the qualities of Islam, then whom will they learn about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from? And this is why I keep on quoting the statement of Lord Bernard Shaw. For those people who have read his book, he said Islam is the best religion, but Muslims are the worst followers. Why? What led him to say this is because how we Muslims carry ourselves. Ask yourself, if I am interacting with a person, a non-Muslim who is a potential Muslim, if you're interacting with him and he learns nothing from your interaction, you have to question yourself. If you have people working for you in your house as non-Muslims, and after 1 year, 2 years, they left and they did not take anything from you, or they did not embrace Islam at the end of the year, wallahi, you will be questionable in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Understand this. And this is why I keep on exerting upon the youth, correct your akhlaq. Deal with people in such a manner that those people want to be like you. What does the dua of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means? رَبَّنَا هَبْلَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنَ وَجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. And make us the imams of the pious. Does it mean an imam who leads salah? An imam who gives the khutbah, the Friday sermon? Not at all. An imam means a role model, a perfect example for people to follow. When you're coming out for Fajr, you are walking along the path. Pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. Oh Allah, set a good example from me for the rest of the people who are sleeping, or those people who I'm passing by, they see me going to the masjid. Make me a good example so that they can be part of those people who pray Salatul Fajr. When you are attending this gathering here, thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا, so that He can make you a good example for others to follow. Be an example to others, but a good example, not a bad example. Because history will remain to remember you. History remembers every person for his good. If you come with evil, not only will history remember you, but even if they caught you, they will caught you with your evil. And you will remain to be cursed till the end of times. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ya ayyuhan nas." Look at the context. He's arriving upon a group of people who are majority of them, the bulk of them, non-Muslims. The Muslims were just a handful. And he calls out to them and he says, "Ya ayyuhan nas, O people, afshu salam, afshu salam." What do we learn? What do we take home from this? Ya ayyuhan nas. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving a hint to every single one of us, me and you. It's our obligation, it's our duty to deliver the message.
يَا أَيُّهَا الرَّسُولُ بَلِّغْ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ وَمَا عَلَيْكَ إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His responsibility was to deliver the message. Our responsibility is to follow and to take cue from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by delivering the message. Our responsibility is not to compel and force people into the religion. La ikraha fi ad-deen, there's no compulsion in the religion. At the end of the day, we cannot place people upon a guidance. That is the responsibility of the Prophet, of not the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Innaka la tahdi man ahbabta.
You cannot guide, you cannot place into guidance that person whom you love. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. The responsibility of placing into guidance is the responsibility of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to understand this, specifically the youth who are involved in da'wah organizations, in da'wah movements. Don't despise that person you're giving da'wah to. You cannot despise anyone, even if the person is sinful, even if his sins have filled the horizons of the skies. You cannot despise him. Hate the sin and not the sinner. The sin, listening music. The sin, indulgement in zina wal-iyadhu billah. The sin, flirting around. The sin, whatever it is. That's not the disease. Understand this. That's the symptoms of a disease. The disease lies in the heart. The disease lies in the heart. If you condemn that person, he might as well just hate Islam for the rest of his life. How many incidents of people, how they were dealt with, led them to totally leave Islam? Islam is a religion of salam and love. This is what the Prophet ﷺ started with. Afshu salam, spread salam. What is salam? Salam has got two meanings. And the first meaning also leads to the next. Allama Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, in his commentary of Riyadh al-Saliheen, Kitab al-Salam, the first page of Kitab al-Salam, after the second half of the page, look what he writes about the meaning of salam. Amazing! I mean, 99.99% of Muslims, if you ask them today, what's the meaning of salam? What does salam entail? They will struggle to answer. And these were the basics of Islam. This is the first statement the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving a group of people when he arrived in Medina. A group of people that was not only Muslims, but majority non-Muslims. Afshu salam, spread salam. Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala says, as-salamu du'a. First and foremost, salam is a du'a. What does it mean, salam is a dua? When I am shaking the hand of my brother and telling him, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, I'm actually telling him that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confer his safety upon you and the blessings of sound health upon you. And it also entails that you are safe and secure from the evil. Not only from the evil of my tongue, but also from the evil of my hand. Al-Muslimu man salim al-Muslimuna min lisanihi wa yadihi. A Muslim, a true, perfect Muslim, is that Muslim whom other people are safe from the evil of his tongue and the evil of his limbs. This is what you have. So can you imagine those brothers, those people of us, amidst us, who say salam to their fellow brothers, and after saying salam, they give them a smack. Does that not contradict the meaning of salam? Imagine you're saying, may the peace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon you. This is a covenant between me and you. I'm promising you that you'll be under safety. Then once I leave, I disintegrate your honor by backbiting you. See that girl there? Seen her for the first time. You really don't know her. Only if you had you known her, man, you don't even say salam to her. Brothers, you let me say manze. Wachan tunaye. Nimempa salamu leo lakini manze mimi hata ujamaa siwezi kumsalimu tena. This is our attitude. You just say peace. It contradicts the entire... And those people who have arguments with other people, you have arguments at home, probably with your parents, which is wrong. I'm not condoning that. But regardless, or those people who are married with your wives, and then later on you leave, and she says, at least say salam before you leave, and you slam the door and say, salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. That contradicts salam. Afshu salam wa at'imu at'am. Feed the food. Feed the food to the people. Salam also entails one more meaning, that we are an ummah of peace. This comes to the next meaning. It leads me to the next meaning of salam. It's an ummah of peace. Wherever you go, be people who spread peace. Be people whose actions denote and symbolize and represent peace, love, unity, harmonious relationships, amicable relationships and environment should be created by a Muslim. Wa at'imu at'am, feed the food. What does this entail? This means that we are a group of people that should be concerned about societal issues. Muslims are those people who are on the front line of societal issues. There are societal problems, and there are many societal problems out there. The first people who should be concerned with regards to societal problems are not the ulama, are not the scholars. It's a responsibility of each one of us. Wa at'imu at'am, wasilu al-arham. And I'll finish with this. I'll finish this hadith and I'll sit. I only have 3 minutes remaining. Wasilul arham. And maintain your family ties and kinship. Wallahi, this is so imperative today. Every second day, I get a case from a parent whereby the son is disobedient. I get a case from an uncle. Probably the brother is not talking to him. The aunt is not really bothered about maintaining family ties. Respected brothers, wallahi, the ayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is enough of Surah Al-Ra'd. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one surah, at the very half of the 17th juz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strikes a balance between the characteristics. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the characteristics. He draws a contrast between the characteristics of the people of Jannah and the people of Jahannam. وَالَّذِينَ يَصِلُونَ, those people who maintain family ties, this is the characteristic of the people of Jannah. On the opposite side of the coin, the people of Jahannam, وَالَّذِينَ يَقْطَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَنْ يُوصَلَ وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ اللَّعْنَةِ. This is enough of an admonishment. وَالَّذِينَ يَقْطَعُونَ, those people who savor, they break the ties we have ordered to be maintained and bonded. These people are causing mischief on the face of earth and they deserve the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence the curse of Allah is upon them. You have a mother out there. You afford to give your friend a smile, your female friend a smile, your brotherly friend a smile, and your mom, who is in her old age, is deprived of your smile, of the warmth of your smile. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And the people who are doing da'wah, the people who pray 5 times a day, and this is the family ties. Wallahi, you can deceive the world as you want to deceive, but the reality of your situation is known by your parents, by your family. If wallahi, they bear a testimony before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of qiyamah that you are a man of perfect morals and characters, Jannah is guaranteed for you. Let the remaining people say whatever they want to say. Your mother is not okay with you. Your brother is not okay with you. Your father is not. And most of these ties are savored because of materialistic reasons. At the extent of your mother, seriously, money at the extent of your brother. وَصَلُّوا وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامُ. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and pray when people are asleep. This is the relationship between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stellar. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned tahajjud because tahajjud is the queen of ibadat. A person who maintains tahajjud can barely, rarely, I'm not saying he would not, but rarely miss the 5 times prayers. Have something with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a daily basis, whatever it is. 2 rakahs of salah, fi jawfil layl, li dhulmatil qabr. As Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala used to say, 2 rakahs in the night, in the darknesses of the night, for the darknesses of the grave. That's a quid pro quo, as they say. This for that. Understand this, respected brothers. Your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be stellar. I'll finish with this. Unfortunately, today we judge a person by this 4th characteristic. A person by his salah. A person by his jama'ah in the masjid. A person by his this and that. We forget all the first 3 things. Salam, this gives a hint to one akhlaq. Our akhlaq should be pure. How is the akhlaq of the person? Wa at'imu at'am, concerned about societal problems. That's Muslim. That's a Muslim. That's how the ummah should be. Number three, your relationship with your family, with your close people. Wa anzir ashirataka al-aqrabin also falls here. What's your relationship with your close people? These three things, if a person perfects them with his connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, تَدْخُلُ جَنَّةَ رَبِّكُمْ بِسَلَامٍ. But if you're the only person, you maintain your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, number one, you don't even care about, number two, you place a blind eye, number three, you place a deaf ear to that, you only have one out of four, you know where you stand. Respected brothers and sisters, it's a high time for us to understand who we should be as Muslims, where we stand as youth, what's our responsibilities. And I invoke you, and I appeal to you, leave out all what is against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and come to Allah. Fafirru ila Allah. Come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have done a lot of wrong. We are humans. We fall short. We fall down. We are not flawless. We are bound to make mistakes. We are not infallible. We are fallible. The doors of tawbah are open. Come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what I complete my words with. Come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.